kind of mistake, and it's all my fault. It's not Diane's fault, so please blame that on me. Our scripture is not in Mark, as the bulletin says. Our scripture is coming from 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. A familiar story. Paul's telling us some of his problems, where he says in chapter 12, verses 7 through 10, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, and in persecutions, in distress, for Jesus Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. While I was in Norway, I did some reading about some of the folks that have made an impact on the world over the years that came from Norway. And one of the folks that I read about that intrigued me was a young man named Ole. And Ole, O-L-E, not Ole, he was Norwegian, not Spanish. He was born in 1877, and about when he was 5 or 6, he migrated to the United States and lived in Wisconsin. And Ole grew to be a good-looking, strapping young man, and as any 19, 20, 21-year-old young man does, he fell in love with this beautiful, beautiful young lady. And he asked her one day, "Would you go with me Sunday afternoon on a picnic out there on that island, out in the lake?" And she smiled coyly and nodded her head. So at the appointed time, he went and got her. And she had on this beautiful dress with about a dozen petticoats in it. And he was dressed in his suit with a high collar. And they were fit to be tied. They looked beautiful. So he rowed them out to this island. And he dragged the boat onto the shore. And he spread that picnic out before her underneath a tree. And he was so hypnotized by her beauty that he hardly even felt or knew about the perspiration. It was just flowing off of him because it was summertime. And softly she cooed to him, "Oh, you forgot the ice cream." And he looked, and sure enough, there was no ice cream. So he pulled the boat back into the water. He rowed back to the shore. He found a grocery store. He bought the ice cream, and he rowed back to the island. And he took it to her, and she batted those big, long eyelashes. And she purred once again to him, "Oh, you forgot the chocolate syrup." So love will make a man or a woman do strange things. And Ole got back into that boat, and he returned to that grocery store for the Hershey syrup. And he rowed back to the island, and on his way, all of a sudden he stopped. And he sat there. John, do you know who this is? You look like you do. All of a sudden, he stopped in the middle of the lake, and he had this brainstorm. He was fascinated by the idea, and he sat there for almost 2 hours. Well, of course, the girl's on the island, and guess what's happened to the ice cream? It's melted. But he finally goes on. But in those 2 hours, Ole Evinrude invented the outboard motor in his brain. And this is a true story. From that date with the young lady came the outboard motor, Floyd, John, as we know it, that powers your bass boat or whatever. And that's where it came from. And old Evan Rude gives us a great illustration of a basic principle of how Christians are so not supposed to live. When life delivers us a problem, and how many of you all have problems? Or when life delivers us a pain, and how many of you have pains every now and then, we can force those problems or those pains or those demons. You know, that pain that I have in my leg, that's a demon. That, we can force those pains to pay dividends. When life gives us a thorn that we can't remove with God's help, then it's our responsibility and it's within our capability with God's help to take that thorn and produce a rose out of it. Bruce Larson is a wonderful minister that some of you may be familiar with. And he makes this statement, in every disaster, God has a gift for you, for me. And then he gives us a two-word sermon. Bruce Larson says, claim it. It's yours. In chapter 12, what I just read, Paul's letter there, to the second letter to the Corinthians, he illustrates this truth in his own life, and he says, a thorn was given to me. What was this thorn? We have no idea. There's conjecture, there's history. Some people say it was his wife. Some people say it might have been his mother-in-law. All of this is conjecture. We don't know what it was, but we do know that Paul, from time to time, was totally disabled by it. And even though there's no evidence to support the wife or mother-in-law or whatever it was, he had a thorn. It could have been epilepsy. There are those who think it was that. There are those that think it was migraines. There was a malarial fever that was common in that part of the world at that time. Some suggest that, but we really don't know. But what we do know is, what did Paul refer to that thorn as? He said that thorn was a messenger of who? A messenger of Satan. Now, the Bible teaches us that all diseases and all death came into the world because of sin. God's perfect original creation, that Garden of Eden, didn't include sin. And it didn't include disease. And it didn't include death. People don't get sick. And people don't die because God wants them to. People get sick and die because our world became flawed by sin. And now, in this flawed universe that you and I live in, the thorns are scattered indiscriminately. Doesn't care how old we are. Doesn't matter how good looking we are. Doesn't matter how much money we've got, or how fat, or how thin, or how whatever we are, we're going to get our thorns. Just like a deck of cards is dealt out, and somewhere there's going to be a thorn in that. And those thorns go to those who might deserve them, and those thorns go to those who might not. Thorns come in all shapes. Thorns come in all sizes. They can be migraine headaches. They can be frustration. They can be sadness. They can be loneliness. It can be a bad back. It can be a bad leg. It can be depression. It can be anxiety. It can be shingles. You name it. You name it. It can be a wild child or a child that is strayed from where we think they ought to go, and on and on and on. And thorns vary in length. And they vary in severity. But most of us, at any given time, have at least one. Don't raise your hand. But think about it. What is your thorn? What are your thorns? And as you think about that, Let's look at what Paul did about his thorn and how God responded. Paul says three times, I besought the Lord about this. Paul prayed to God on three occasions, and he asked God to remove the thorn. But God did what? Nothing. God answered the prayer. He said no. He didn't do anything about it. And there's no place in our Bible, there's no place in the Word, in the Gospel, that says God is going to always answer our prayers affirmatively. Nowhere does it say God is always going to answer our prayers the way we want Him to. Remember the garden? Jesus prayed not once, not twice, three times for God to take the cross away from Him, to spare Him the agony of death. And God's answer was no. And Jesus accepted it willingly. I am not a country music fan by any stretch. But a number of years ago, there was a song that told the story of a young man. And he and his wife went to their 10th high school class reunion. And they walked in and they mixed and mingled. And all of a sudden, this man's eyes focused on the girl that he had been so smitten with when he was in high school, that he was just in love beyond words with her. And as he looked at her, he became so thankful for his wife. And he squeezed his wife's hand a little bit harder. He squeezed his wife's hand a little bit harder because those 10 years had not been kind to his old high school friend, flame. And he realized very quickly that her current appearance did not equal what she looked like 10 years ago with those memories he had. And the memory and the years had been tough on her. And he was so proud that he had ended up with his wife rather than the one that was there that he had been so in love with 10 years ago. But he remembered the many, many occasions that 10 years ago where he had prayed fervently, Lord, I ask only one thing of you, help me win the heart of this girl. And he didn't. And then comes the refrain of that country song, thank God for unanswered prayers. You know, he ended up with the beauty and not the other one. Now, sometimes our prayers don't receive positive responses in our minds because God is so much smarter than we are. God knows so much better than I do what I need, and He knows better than you do what you need. He knows there's something else that's better for us. But then that brings, what about our prayers for sick people? We know that God wants healing instead of illness. Why do some prayers for healing seem to be answered in a positive manner? And some prayers are not. I pray for healing for our sick people, and you do too, all of the time. And I believe that our prayers, mine, yours, everyone's, are always answered. God heals in three ways. You know that. I'm not telling you something you don't know. God heals first and foremost, the most common way. It's through the touch, the hands, the education, the experience, the knowledge of physicians. And I thank God for all of the wonderful doctors in the world. And we depend on those medical channels. The second way, though, that God heals is through ways that we don't understand, and nor do people in the medical profession. Because there's no explaining when someone gets well. What do we call those healings? We call them miracles. We call those miracles that even the most experienced doctor cannot explain in any satisfactory measure. And the third way that God heals would be be experienced by all of us who call Jesus Lord. And that's healing is what happens to us when we go